Wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome to Ask Huda. I'm your host, Jamil Rashid, and I'd like to welcome back with me today, Sheikh Muhammad Salah. Assalamu alaikum.
Alaykum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Thank you very much, Sheikh, for being with us today.
My pleasure.
Okay, and you're with us today as well. Our telephone numbers should be popping up on your screen. The country code is 202. Then it's 38555, 248 or 249. If you want to send us an email, do so at askask@huda.tv. And just the two announcements, the same one as usual. If you're going to call us, turn down your television sets. And secondly, if you call us, please call us early. We get so many calls at the second part of the show, and so many of you are left disappointed. So please do call early. Let's start off with a question from Sister Nihal Sheikh from Egypt. We got her question slightly incorrect in the last episode. We're just going to correct it. She said, I read a hadith of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam that he said, to cure your sick, increase in charity. She says, is this hadith daif? Is it something which is not correct, Sheikh?
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على نبيه ومصطفى سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. All praise due to Allah, who praise him and who seek his help. Whomsoever Allah guides is a truly guided one, and whomsoever Allah leaves astray, no one can show him guidance. I bear witness that there is no God worthy of worship but Allah, and I bear witness that Muhammad, peace be upon him, is his last messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And there is a hadith which is narrated by Abu Dawood and others, and it is judged as fair or hasan by Sheikh Al-Albani, may Allah have mercy on his soul, that says, "Dawu mardakum bil-sadaqa." So this hadith is judged as fair as far as soundness and authenticity, which literally means treat your sick people by the means of giving in a charity. There are other sound hadith also which supported that meaning, such as that giving in a charity, especially the secret or the concealed charity, is a mean of repelling the evil, protecting one from calamities, from disasters, and from an evil death as well. So basically, giving in a charity is a mean of changing one's decree, as long as it did not happen yet. As the Prophet ﷺ also stated in one hadith, that there is a state of competition between one's prayer, dua, and his qadr. And if the dua is sincere and is regular, the dua could overcome the qadr and it would not take place. And all of that was also preordained by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whether will it take place or not. So giving in a charity would repel the evil consequences by the leave of Allah as well, and it can cure the sick. And I heard of somebody whom whenever he would get sick and would visit the physician and would write him a prescription, he would go to the pharmacist and ask him, how much is it, the medication which is listed in this prescription. And he would donate the same amount, the price of the medication, would donate it, and he would not buy the medication. I'm not suggesting that to the viewers, nor am I saying this is the Sheikh's prescription. I'm saying that this is a very special relationship between this person, who is very righteous, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he would give in a charity the same amount and he would be cured without taking the medication or encountering any side effects. So it is recommended during regular times to give in a charity in order to protect one from calamities. And during calamities, to increase giving in a charity in order to get a fast and a quick relief.
Jazakallah khair, Sheikh. Okay, Sister Razwana from the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia asked a question about some of the elders, a saying rather. She says, some of our elders say that we leave utensils which are dirty or utensils we've eaten in unwashed throughout the night. In the morning, they're going to be visited by Satan or something close to that. She wants to know, is this something true?
There are several sound hadith were narrated in this regard. The hadith which I'm going to quote right now is narrated by Jabir ibn Abdullah, may Allah be pleased with him and his father. And the text is for Imam Muslim, may Allah have mercy on him. He said that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, غطوا الإناء وَأَوْكِئُ السِّقَاءَ وَأَغْلِقُ الْأَبْوَابَ وَأَطْفِئُ السِّرَاجَ. And in another narration, and by the way, it's also narrated by Imam Bukhari in his beautiful book, The Individual Etiquette. It says, وَخَمِّرُ الْإِنَاءَ, which means, first of all, the narration of Imam Muslim, which says, غَطُّ الْإِنَاءَ. غَطُّ الْإِنَاءَ means cover up your kitchen containers, your utensils. So that means if they do have a cover, whether they contain food or not, most specifically if they contain food or leftover, you must cover them, especially at night. And we'll learn why. And istiqa is the water skin, because he used to preserve the water in a water skin. So tie up the neck of the water skin, tie it up. And أَغْلِقُ الْأَبْوَابَ, and close the doors and lock them at night. فَإِنَّ الشَّيْطَانَ, since Satan does not neither unlock doors, nor does he untie the neck of the water skin, nor does he uncover the covered utensils. We all know that Satans eat from the leftover. The jinn, normally, they eat from the leftover, especially the bones, etc. So leaving the utensils uncovered is a mean of inviting them to come in and enter and eat from this leftover food or drink from this water, as long as it is uncovered. So when we comply with this command, we protect ourselves from the entry of Satan's as well. So whether it's leftover or the pan is full of food, and even if it is empty, the scholars recommended that it should be turned upside down if it does not have a cover. So these are beautiful Islamic etiquettes instructed by the Prophet ﷺ. Awesome. على وجه الندب. What does it mean? It's recommended to do that. It's not mandatory though. So for those who would like to protect themselves at night from Satan's and his followers, then once you enter, you say, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. You enter your house, mention the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He deprives Satan from entering. He says to his company, لا مبيت لكم اليوم. There is no entry for you here tonight. You're not going to spend the night here. And if one does not mention the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then Satan would invite his followers and says, ضمننا المبيت. We guarantee to spend the night here tonight. Then if the person is ready to eat and he starts eating without mentioning the name of Allah, then Satan would invite his followers and say, ضمننا المبيت والعشاء. We guarantee lodging and dinner as well. So mentioning the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, like in the doors at night, I'm talking about the main doors, not necessarily the each doors. Room. Mm-hmm. And covering the utensils, the containers, even if they're empty, or turning them upside down, is a prophetic teachings with regards to protecting oneself and family from Satan and his company.
And what about the specifics of this question, where the sister's asking about utensils which are not cleaned, utensils which are unwashed?
Same. Because this is the leftover. That's why I started by quoting the hadith.
Okay, great.
I said even if the utensils are clean, it's recommended to turn them upside down according to the prescription of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. In addition to, there are other hadith which talk about Satan's here as hawam or insects. Mm-hmm. Of course, utensils which have leftover food unwashed is a feast for insects and ants and others. So basically, it's recommended to make sure that you clean up house before you go to sleep.
Jazakallah khair, Sheikh. Okay, first call of the day, Brother Burhan from Bahrain. Brother, you're live on Ask Huda. Your question, please.
Assalamu alaikum, Jamil brother and Sheikh Salah.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Inshallah, I'm going to perform Hajj this year with my wife and dad.
Congratulations.
I have about three questions for you.
Okay.
First question is that during Ihram, is it possible for us to change the Ihram? Because I know this gets dirty with the people and performing
Yep.
Hajj.
Okay.
Second question is, does female Ihram has to be white?
Okay.
And the third one is, we are going to perform Hajj at Tamattu, mm-hmm. between the Umrah and Hajj, mm-hmm. while out of Ihram.
Sorry, could you repeat the last question?
We are going to Hajj at Tamattu. Mm-hmm. Can we fast between the Umrah and Hajj while
fast.
Out of Ihram?
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. Okay. Wa alaykum as-salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. That's Brother Burhan from Bahrain. Jazakallah khair for the question, brother. Okay, I've got a question here from Sister Malik from Qatar. She says, I was married without my will. Okay, she was forced into a marriage by her grandfather to my cousin, she says. We don't live together. We live in separate houses. We've asked for a divorce, but he won't grant me a divorce. Am I allowed to ask for khula, Sheikh, she's asking.
An-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, in a very sound hadith that is collected by Al-Bukhari and Muslim and narrated by Abu Hurairah, may Allah be pleased with him, لا تنكح الأيم حتى تستأمر ولا تنكح البكر حتى تستأذن. قال وما إذنها يا رسول الله؟ قال سكوتها. In this fantastic hadith, which is the cornerstone in any mas'ala that's similar to this case. And a wonderful reference with regards to marriage. Mm-hmm. That the Prophet ﷺ said, a woman who has been previously married, whether was divorced or been widowed, it's not permissible to marry her off. It's not permissible for her guardian to marry her off to somebody without her consultation, without consulting her. Hatta tustamar. And with regards to al-bikr, the virgin girl, it's not permissible to give her in marriage without her permission. So they said, Ya Rasulullah, and what is her permission? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, is to remain quiet. Because the bikr, a woman who's not been married before, is more shy than anybody else whenever the parents or the guardian would offer her marriage and say, somebody is asking for your hand. So they were asking, does she have to say, yes, I agree? He said, no, but just being quiet, saying nothing and keeping silent, that's a permission. But if she objects and says, no, I don't like him, I don't think so, etc., then this objection should be taken in consideration, and that means there is no marriage, there is no valid marriage, whether the woman has been married before, or she is a virgin, it is not permissible to give her in marriage to any person without her permission, even if this person is the most righteous person. And the Prophet ﷺ judged in a similar case when a girl came to him and said that, my father gave me in marriage to my cousin against my will. He gave her the choice. If you wish, we separate you, and if you wish, you will continue. So basically, the scholars have agreed that it is not permissible for any guardian, even if the guardian happens to be the father, to give his daughter or the girl who's under his guardianship, whether ayyim or bikr, in marriage without their consent or permission under any circumstances. Now, there remains a very important nut, which is, if the girl was married against her will and she did not show any resentment, and the marriage was consummated, and they lived together for years, and she allowed this person to embrace her intimately, and now maybe they have children or not, as long as there was a relationship between them, and she did not show any objection or resentment, the scholar said that means she did agree. But as long as she's objecting, this marriage is an invalid marriage. So basically, there is no marriage in the first place. And how to solve this misery? By taking the whole case to the court, any court in the Muslim world would understand this condition and would give the girl the right of separating herself from this person who supposedly forced himself on her as a husband without her consent.
Jazakallah khair, Sheikh. Okay, next, Sister Sumaya from the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia. Sister, you're live on Ask Her. Your questions, please.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. How are you?
Welcome, alhamdulillah. Jazakallah khair.
Sheikh, please pray for us because we are nine sisters and want to get married with a righteous man. Okay. And I called you last week, I called you, I talked about some rahmah, and now I feel more rahmah at my home.
Alhamdulillah.
I get a job, alhamdulillah, very good job now.
Alhamdulillah.
I want to ask what is the qualities of husband? Should we look in the... Islam, in the man. What is the quality of Islamic husband?
Inshallah.
And can you explain me the verse number 35 of Surah Nuh?
Okay,
inshallah.
Jazakallah khair. Sister Sumaya there from the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia. Now we've got the next sister, Sister Zuwa from Canada. Sister, you're live in Ask Her. Your question, please.
Yes. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Okay, my first question is, can I put perfume on when I am at home? And is my prayer valid if I have the perfume on?
Okay.
And my second question is, can I pray in my own words inside the salah before the sleep? And my last question is, can I pray from a book while doing tawaf?
But okay. First of all, before answering your question, Zawa, you have to tell us, how old are you?
I'm 9 years old.
9 years.
And is it really cold in Canada right now?
Okay, Jazakallah khair, Sister Zoa there from Canada, one of our younger viewers. Of course, you can watch Huda TV on the internet by going to www.huda.tv. We welcome all of our viewers from the internet. Jazakallah khair for that call from Sister Zoa. Okay, we've got a few questions from Brother Sam from Yemen, Sheikh. The first, he says, I reverted to Islam over 3 years ago. At the beginning, I was very strong in my iman, but nowadays it seems to be dropping, being lowered. I try to do things, but I stagnate. I never finish those things. He goes, I want to increase my iman. How do I carry on and how do I start fighting this shit?
First of all, we pray for you. May Allah keep you steadfast on the straight path and support you and increase your iman. Uh-huh. And all the viewers and all of us as well. Second, this is a human nature, especially with the believers. The mainstream, or the scholars of this ummah, are of the view that the iman increases and decreases. It's a subject to increase and decrease. Third, the Prophet ﷺ has guided us to the actions which would lead us to increase in our iman. In one hadith, the Prophet ﷺ was asked about the best deed ever. Mm-hmm. The Prophet ﷺ's answer was, أَدْوَمُهُ وَإِنْقَلْ. He said, the one which is constant, even if it is a little. Mm-hmm. And I warn myself and others against taking upon ourselves the responsibility or the duty or vow to do a lot of things at once and to commit ourselves to do them on every single day. Then what happens is, of course, we can afford it because you're humans and we have so many other things to do. So if somebody wants, for instance, to start practicing the night prayer and at the tahajjud, then I advise by beginning by 2 rak'ahs at night. You maintain them on regular basis for a whole month until you get used to them, you like them. Of course, after that you offer the witr. So when you get used to them and they become a part of your life, a routine, mm-hmm. and you don't have any problem offering them before you go to sleep or you get up before Fajr and you pray the 2 rak'ahs along with Salatul Witr, then you may increase them and so on until you come to the optimal level. But one who begins right away and say, tonight I will pray 20 rak'ahs, I bet you that will be the first and the last night that he's going to pray at night. Same thing, since the Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam advised Abdullah, the son of Amr ibn al-As, and others that to take it easy on yourselves. So begin slowly and take it easy, but remain constant. If you adopt a good deed, whether it's a given in a charity, sadaqah, or fasting 3 days every month, then Mondays and Thursdays, then if you want to increase maximum every other day, that is the best fasting. With the rest of the ibadat, we deal with them likewise. So if you begin easy, then steadfast and constant, this is how you remain steadfast and you don't have any problem, nor you feel bored. Because this is a human nature, which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala addresses us with this and says that, the Prophet ﷺ said, إِنَّ الدِّينَ يُسْرٌ وَلَنْ يُشَادَّ الدِّينَ أَحَدٌ إِلَّا غَلَبَهُ. So this is what I advise you with regards to maintaining your iman or increasing the level of your iman and practicing good deeds as much as you can.
Jazakallah khair. The brother had a second question, Sheikh. He says, I live with my wife in Yemen. She's Yemeni. But I have to travel back to the US where he's from. Every time I go to the US, I get busy with family involved, and thus sometimes it's up to a year I stay there. Is this allowed for him to stay 1 year away from his wife, Sheikh?
Well, the scholar said the maximum period that the husband should keep away from his wife is 6 months, up to 6 months. And mm-hmm. this is the judgment and the ruling of the leader of the believers, Umar ibn Khattab, the second caliph, may Allah be pleased with him.
Ameen.
And if the conditions require the person to stay for a longer period and the wife does not mind and she is not suffering, because the most important thing is fulfilling the needs of the wife too. We always concern, we're always concerned and focus on the needs of the man. Mm-hmm. And that's why we said that if a man invited his wife to bed and she does not accept, Allah is angry with her and so on. What about the woman? She too has needs. So when the man travels for 6 months, this is the maximum period that the wife could keep away from the husband. Beyond that, he needs her permission, unless if it is necessary, such as if the person has been sent to prison for a couple of years or 3 years, this is not his choice, or he's been retained somewhere, or they are broke and there is no fund whatsoever, and he has to work for an entire year in order to make his earning for his family and to provide for his kids and those who are under his guardianship. So if he can arrange that with his wife and there is no problem with that, then it is permissible. Otherwise, one should really keep in mind the needs of his wife, because otherwise that could lead to falling into haram.
Jazakallah khair, Sheikh. Okay, next we have Sister Yusuf from Egypt. Sister, you're live and ask her your question, please.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Jazakallah khair, and I enjoy your show. This Ask Huda is my favorite show.
Alhamdulillah. Thank you.
My question is, Sheikh, is it allowed in Islam to give your kidney if someone you love is need of kidney and you can give? Can you give? Is it allowed?
Okay.
We'll answer you, inshallah.
Jazakallah khair, sister. Sister, I'm Yusuf there from Egypt. Jazakallah khair for the question, sister. Okay, let's get through some of these questions. Sister Sabah from Canada, Sheikh. She says, how can I pray for the people who I love who have passed away, such as my uncles, aunts, grandparents? Can I read Quran for them, Sheikh? What can I do for them to give them blessings, Sheikh?
Praying for them, as you just suggested in the beginning, by asking Allah to cover them with His mercy and forgive them their sins. By giving any charity or food in the or feeding the poor, and then granting them the reward of this charity that reaches them as well. These are the acts which were certain that the reward of these acts would reach the dead person, whether you know him or not, as long as you do that on their estate or in their behalf. Also, the performance of Umrah and Hajj, have they not performed Umrah or Hajj before, that would work as well. But as far as reading the Quran and giving them the reward of your recitation, that's not confirmed that it would reach them by any means. Yet, you can read the Quran, then after reading the Quran, now you are at a level where when you invoke Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, your dua is most likely to be accepted. So after reciting the Quran, or after praying at night, or after giving any charity, or doing a good deed, or upon completing your fasting, when you include them in your dua, that is much more effective than if you do something which was not certain whether it would help or not.
Jazakallah khair, Sheikh. Okay, before we take the next question from there, we've got Sister Amina from Egypt. Sister, you're live on Ask Huda. Your question, please. Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Yes, my question is, in Islam, is suicide bombing permissible if you're in jihad?
Okay, jazakallah khair, sister. Barakallah fik, sister Amina there from Egypt. Okay, sister Sabah had another question, Sheikh. She said in the program Visitor at Home, and if you want to know about our program, just quickly, just go to www.huda.tv. You'll find a program listing of all our programs and what times they come on. You explained that we should not get our children to always tell us their secrets, but nowadays the world they live in is not very pleasant, and we need to know what they've been up to. Can you give some explanation on this, please, Sheikh?
Even though the program was recorded more than almost 3 years ago, I think I do remember that we discussed a very important issue with regards to revealing secrets. I said we should train our children not to reveal other secrets. Have they been entrusted with a secret? And I also remember that quote in the story of Anas ibn Malik in the hadith that Anas used to serve the Prophet ﷺ when he was young. He served him for 10 years. So he taught us beautiful etiquette that he learned from the Prophet ﷺ. He said once the Prophet ﷺ sent him somewhere and he asked him to keep it as a secret. So when he was late, his mother asked him, "What kept you late? What happened? You didn't come on time." He said, "Well, the Prophet ﷺ sent me somewhere and he did not want me to reveal it." So the mother applauded her son's behavior and she said, "Well, son, if the Prophet ﷺ entrusted you with a secret, then you should not reveal it to no one." This is one thing which we should really teach ourselves and our children. Because the Nabi ﷺ in one hadith says that if somebody speaks to you and addresses you in a fashion that you understand from that it's a secret, then once you guys depart, this is an amanah. He entrusted you with a trust that you should not reveal it nor disclose it to anybody else because he entrusted you. That's an amanah. The other thing which is, I highly recommend for the parents to follow up on their children's behavior. There should not be closed doors. There should not be passwords for their children. And I recently suggested to one of my friends who installed wireless in his house for the internet service. I said, "Listen, If there is wireless, then there should not be closed doors. No more passwords, or at least you have an access to the password. That helps the son or the daughter to feel that they have been supervised. Supervision is not a bad thing. It's actually the best thing. Many of the youth who've gone astray or fell into gangs or traps, they complained that there was no supervision. Parents never asked them. They just wanted money. They gave them the allowance. They gave them extra. Even they put the wallet or they put the cash before the children, and they did not notice that the children were stealing. So basically, they encouraged them negatively or passively to fall into mistakes and errors until it became a habit, whether drugs or smoking or illicit relationships. No more closing doors behind you, because Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says with regards to adults, none of you should sleep by himself separately without having somebody with him, nor travel alone by himself. Because in another hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِنَّ الذِّئْبَ لَا يَأْكُلُ مِنَ الْغَنَمِ إِلَّا الْقَاصِيَةِ. The wolf normally devours of the sheep that one which goes astray by itself, but as long as they are in a herd with the shepherd, they're well protected. And every one of you is a guardian, is a shepherd. And he will be asked about those who are under his guardianship. So you have to have a full supervision. Know who are the friends and the colleagues of your children, of your son and daughter. Whom does she speak to on the phone? Is it a boy or a girl? What does he, what does she want from her? So you have to show them that you're fully aware of everything, and there is no problem with that whatsoever. Many people say, I trust my son 100%, that's perfectly fine. But are you blind? Don't you know what's going on? You're acting blind. Until now you realize that the principal would call you up and say that, you know that your son is a member in a gang, or he's in drugs, or. And I'm saying this out of experience. I was involved in family counseling and raising the youth for years, to the point that some youth, they acted as very religiously committed, and they were caught involved in drugs. So the parents could not believe that, and they went all the way in their stubbornness and in their argument with the principal. No way, and we're going to take them for the test and so on. Even though the children, or the boy or the girl, were in drugs, but they deceived the parents still. So when they took them for the test, and it was positive, they were shocked. I was not, because I knew that they were involved in that. Because when the father or the mother or the parents overtrust, I do not overtrust myself. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam regularly asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect him and to keep his heart firm on his deen. He said, Allahumma ya muqallib al-qulub, thabbit qalbi ala deenik. We invoke Allah and ask him, Allahumma ahina muslimina wa tawaffana muslimin. Oh Allah, keep us in our life as Muslims, and even at the time of our death, keep us Muslims. So what some people think it is freedom is actually a mean of ruining your children. And I've discussed this in details in the program of Visit at Home. I don't think we have enough time to elaborate on that.
Jazakallah khair, Sheikh. Okay, Sister Aisha from the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia. Sister, you're next on Ask Huda. Your question, please.
Hello, assalamu
alaikum. Wa alaikum assalam.
Alaikum assalam. Wa barakatuh.
I have two questions. The first one is related to Hajj. I actually want to perform Hajj this year, but my kids are very young. They are like 1 year and 3 year old. So my husband is not willing to go and perform Hajj along with the kids. He's saying that it's very troublesome and even not good for the kids, and we'll not be able to perform all the arkans. But financially and physically, we are capable of performing Hajj. So is it still obligatory for us to perform Hajj, or can we, or is it a valid reason that our kids are very, very small and we can just delay it for a couple of years?
Do you have some family members to look after the kids in your absence?
No, there is no one here of whom I can keep my kids. I have to take them along with.
No neighbors, friends?
There's no one here. There's no place. I don't know anyone so closely with whom I can keep my kids.
Okay.
So I have to take them along with if I go for a Hajj.
Okay. We'll answer you, inshallah.
Do you have another question, sister?
My second question, My second question is regarding the Fajr prayer.
Okay.
When I see the timings of the Fajr prayer, there are two prayers, actually, the Fajr and the Ishraq. And they have two different timings. Like the Fajr, for example, is 4:30 and the Ishraq will be around 6 a.m. So till what time is the Fajr prayer valid? Or before I can, like, it's not qada. Till what time can I pray Fajr?
Okay. Jazakallah. Okay, Jazakallah. I've got the questions there. Barakallah feek. Sister Aisha there from the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia. Next up we have Sister Lujain from Qatar. Sister, you're live and ask her your question, please. Sister Lujain, are you with us?
Wa
alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
If we celebrate birthdays, can we give our friends a gift?
That if we?
Gift. Okay. Do you have another question, sister?
No.
Okay. Jazakallah khair, Sister Lujain there from Qatar. Okay, Sheikh, I think I'm going to take up your offer. We've got to have a young Ask Huda for all our young viewers. I think we're getting more younger viewers than older viewers. Okay.
Turn in here.
We're going to take a short break, inshallah. Return with you in a couple of minutes. Please do stay with us. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
You know, sometimes it's important to take a break. We need to take a break. Take a break from what? From the everyday things to look at what we're really doing as Muslims. That's why we said we really need to have this program for you and for me to take a break right here on Huda TV. Stay with us because we've got a lot coming up on Take a Break.
And if you look into the early tafsir, early exegesis of the Quran, you will find that all the mufassirin were trying to find out where are the seven earths. Earthquakes, natural or artificial, can delineate the boundaries between seven different zones within the earth. The conclusion that we have seven different layers within the earth came to not only in the 20th century. The true believer would prostrate down in obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the blessings of that prostration will reach the seventh earth.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome back to Ask Huda. Quickly, I'll remind you of our telephone numbers. Very quickly, country code is 202, then it's 38555 248 or 249. Sheikh, let's take a question here from the SMS, and we do take your questions from SMS. If you want to send it, they'll be coming on the screen and we'll be writing them down here. We've got a question from a sister. She says, my parents live in the United Arab Emirates. I live in Egypt. My dad is so busy, so he can't visit me. He's working all the time. Is it possible for my mother to come and visit me by herself, stay with me for a couple of weeks, and then return by herself to the UAE?
When we discuss the issue of traveling for women without the mahram repeatedly, uh-huh. And we said the opinion of the vast majority of the scholars based on the sound hadith that it's not permissible for a woman who believes in Allah in the last day to travel alone without a male mahram.
Jazakallah khair. Okay, Sister Saba had a last question. She said, if a relative has passed away, can I say Rahimullah, may Allah have mercy on him or her, after their name, Shaykh?
Okay, saying may Allah have mercy on him or her is permissible. Actually, is recommended. It's a dua, an invocation.
Okay.
But there is a difference between this and when some people say, as it is in Arabic, they say Al-Marhum, the one who is receiving the mercy, because we don't know whether he is receiving the mercy or not. So we cannot really be judgmental. Rather, we should only invoke Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We say radiyallahu anhum wa ardahum with regards to the companions and the, their followers. And we say rahimahum Allah to the scholars and the righteous of the ummah and any Muslim who passed away. So it's recommended to say rahimahullah or rahimahullah. May Allah have mercy on him or her.
Okay, jazakallah khair. Okay, I've got a question here now. The sister says, I have a question. Can a female change her undergarments, okay, two or three times a day, but not change her ihram? She's talking about when she's in ihram. Can she keep ihram dress on and change her undergarments? And I'm going to add it with the question of Brother Burhan.
That's smart. Thank you.
He says, does a female ihram, is it white? Is there any conditions for a female ihram?
And let me add to it also the question of changing the ihram for men as well. Mm-hmm. When we say that men wear the ihram, the izar, and the rida, the two towels or the two sheets, one to be wrapped around the waist, that's mm-hmm. the izar, and the other one, the rida, on both shoulders. This is not inseparable. I mean, you can change them so many times as you want, as long as you feel they're dirty or covered with sweat. So you can change them, no problem. That does not affect the ihram, nor would it take you out of the status of ihram. Also, taking a shower to refresh yourself and remove the sweat, that too is permissible as long as you avoid using scented soap, shampoo, or body wash. For the ladies, you can perform ihram in your regular everyday clothes as long as you're covering your entire body properly, except for the hands and the face. You're not wearing colorful clothes. I mean, some women wear rainbow colors. Not wearing see-through hijab or see-through clothes or tight clothes revealing the details of the body. So your regular outfit, which is a long abaya, for instance, and the khimar, that is perfectly fine. Can you change them? Likewise, as we said with regards to men, he can change them regularly, he can take a shower, and he can change the undergarment or the outer garment with no restriction whatsoever. Only for men, it's restricted to wear any stitched clothes during the state of ihram.
Jazakallah khair. Okay, Brother Khurshid from Dubai. Brother, you're next on Ask Huda. Your questions, please.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
So my question is that in India, actually my daughter is going to marry on 4th of February.
Congratulations.
Thank you very much, sir. So what I'm saying that it is very common that they are writing Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim on the card, visiting this marriage card.
Okay.
Or in the name of Allah.
Mm-hmm.
But what I feel personally that the card is used to be used in different ways. Sometimes somebody is throwing or sometimes it is fall down or something like it comes in the feet or something like that.
Mm.
Can you advise me that should I write this? Because my elder brother told me that whenever Nabi Kareem Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam used to write a letter, he starts from Bismillah Rahman Rahim.
That's right.
So okay. Should I write this Bismillah or in the name of Allah from the beginning?
Okay. This is a very smart question, and inshallah, we'll answer it.
Jazakallah khair, brother.
Thank you, Jazakallah.
Brother Khurshid there from Dubai. Next to your brother Fadl Rahman from Bahrain. Brother, you're live in Ask Huda. Your question, please.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Brother, I have two questions.
Okay, fire away.
First question is my mother in law's name is Zulfa. Is there a meaning for that name? And if there is no meaning, like, what should we do? The second question is, there is a salah called Salatul Awabin prayed between Maghrib and Isha. The hadith on which this is based, is it a strong hadith or a weak hadith?
Okay.
Barakallahu feek. Brother Fadl Rahman from Bahrain. Jazakallah for that question, brother. Okay, we had Brother Fasir from the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia ask a couple of questions, Sheikh. How do Yajuj wa Majuj, Yog wa Mog, die, Sheikh? How do they pass away? How are they taken away from this earth?
In the sound hadith of Muslim, may Allah have mercy on him, the Prophet ﷺ narrated that Isa ﷺ and his followers, all of us, the believers at this time, because we all know that Isa ﷺ would come down and would descend to our worldly earth by the end of time. And this, his second coming, is one of the major signs of the occurrence of the Day of Judgment, that precedes the occurrence of the Day of Judgment. So the dilemma of Gog and Magog will be overwhelming. They will be spread all over. They will destroy crops and water. The Prophet ﷺ said in one hadith that they would pass by the lake of Tabariya.
Mm.
By the time the last one of them would come to it, it would be already dried up. They would drink all its water. It's so amazing. So Isa ﷺ would invoke Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to get rid of these people because they cannot fight them. They were able to overcome the false Messiah and his followers, but they had a problem. They will have a problem with Gog and Magog. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will send against them special worm. The worms are known as an-naghaf. Normally, they exist in the noses of the camels and the sheep, which will destroy them all at once. Sudden death. Basically, Isa and his followers will be concealing somewhere. Mm-hmm. And once it will be quiet and there is no noise anymore, they will come out and they will see the earth will be full of their disease and their dead bodies. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would send powerful birds with long necks, and they will pick their bodies and will clear up the earth from their bodies and their dead bodies, and they will take them somewhere. Only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows where will they cast their bodies. But there will be a rotten smell because of their rotten bodies. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will send down a heavy rain which will wash off the entire earth. And this is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to relieve the ummah from the calamity of Gog and Magog by his leave.
Jazakallah khair Sheikh. Okay, brother Ahmed from Qatar, you're next on Askar. Your question, please, brother.
As-salamu
alaykum. Wa alaykum
as-salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
I just wanted to clarify about the beard, since I'm still a bit confused. What I meant to say last time was that my beard is very disheveled from the sides.
Mm-hmm.
Some say I can trim it, others say I can't. Could you please clear that again?
And whatever we said last time will be repeated again, that the vast majority, they stated that you're not allowed to, because this is how the Prophet ﷺ meant with his hadith. And there are some scholars who rely on the practice of Abdullah ibn Umar, may Allah be pleased with him, that he used to trim his beard. So if you choose the opinion of the vast majority, that is best for you, of course. And if you rely on the opinion of the scholars who adopted the view of Abdullah ibn Umar, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept your work.
Jazakallah khair. And that's Brother Ahmed from Qatar. Brother, Jazakallah khair. Do you have another question?
Okay. My other question is it permissible to go to the States for citizenship with the added intention of da'wah?
Okay.
I like that, with the added intention of da'wah.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay, no problem. Jazakallah khair. That's Ahmed, mashallah, from Qatar. Jazakallah khair for that question. Okay, let's go back to some of these questions. Fasif from the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia said some people recite Surah Al-Baqarah completely after Maghrib Salah. He says, is this something from the Sunnah, Sheikh?
Can you repeat the question again?
He recites Surah Al-Baqarah after the Maghrib Salah. I asked him again.
As a practice?
Mm-hmm.
Well, if somebody recites Surah Al-Baqarah or any other surah at any say time, mm-hmm. that's recommended. We just stated in the previous episode that the Prophet ﷺ said, whoever recites Surah Al-Baqarah at night, Satan will not come near to his house for 3 nights.
Mm-hmm.
And whoever recites it in the morning, Satan will keep off from his house for 3 days. So if he's just reciting with this intention, that's fine. But any ibadah, if somebody switches to be a practice that's amended to be done during this time, then we have to raise a question based on what is the reference. And I don't think somebody would do it on daily basis to recite Surah Al-Baqarah after Maghrib. So maybe if we understood the question properly, if you want to recite Surah Al-Maghrib right after sunset, as this is the beginning, after Salat al-Maghrib, as this is the beginning of the night, that's perfectly fine.
Jazakallah khair, Sheikh. Okay, we've got another question from the SMS, Brother Iftikhar. He says, we intend to perform Hajj this year. We're going to Medina from Muscat on the 4th of Dhul-Hijjah. Can we perform Hajj Tamattu, he wants to know. And he said, if we can, do we just assume Ihram for Umrah and then reach Mina with the same Umrah and for same Ihram for Hajj, Sheikh?
That depends. Hajj Tamattu means that you perform the Umrah any say time from the 1st of Shawwal or Dhul Qa'dah,
mm-hmm.
or any day even up to the 8th of Dhul Hijjah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Al-Hajj ashhurum ma'lumat. Al-Hajj are certain known months. That's Shawwal, Dhul Qa'dah, and the first 10 days of Dhul Hijjah.
Mm-hmm.
So if you perform Umrah at any say time, then you exit from your ihram, you mean in tahallul, then once again on the 8th day of the month of Dhul Hijjah, you assume a new intention of performing Hajj, that's known as Hajj al-Tamattu'. So if you're going from Muscat to Medina, you don't worry about making ihram whatsoever. Only upon leaving in Medina, if you're going directly to Mecca, you're going to stop in Mecca, even if your stop happens to be on the 8th day of Dhul Hijjah, prior to going to Al-Madinah, then you may do the Umrah, and you have the choice of shortening or cutting or shaving your hair, then exiting from ihram, then from your place in Mecca, you assume a new intention of doing the hajj by saying, Labbaik Allahumma hajjah. That would be considered as hajj al-tamattu. But if you take off from Medina without stopping in Mecca, you go to Mina, that means you're going to begin with hajj, not with the umrah. Then doing the umrah afterward, it would not be hajj al-tamattu.
Jazakallah khair, Sheikh. Okay, I've got a question here from Sister Aisha, Sheikh. She says, I've been married for 9 years, but I've not seen my husband for 6 years of those 9 years. He was imprisoned without a reason and without a trial. Until now, I haven't been allowed to see him after many requests. What should I do, Sheikh? Should I wait for him? Should I file for a divorce? What should I do?
Throughout the time since last episode, I've been thinking and considering the situation of the sister. And I feel very sorry for her and for her husband. And I wonder if, because I asked her a question, I said, how long is his sentence? How many years is he going to stay in prison? She said, she doesn't know because he's not been tried. He was not taken to a court. He was just kidnapped, whether by authorities or whatever. I wonder, those guys were the cause of this trouble for this family. How are they going to answer Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? This is very repetitive. Those who have kidnapped innocent people, thrown them in Guantanamo, or in secret prisons in Europe, in many Muslim countries. I just want to share something with you. Maybe you don't know it. Maybe you're ignorant, or maybe you're stupid. So I'd like to clarify that to you. There is something called the day of judgment, the day of accountability, that on that day, you will be standing before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with no support, no superpower, no intelligence, no homeland security, no government. No one is going to defend you. On that day, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to ordinary sinners, يَوْمَ يَفِرُّ الْمَرْءُ مِنْ أَخِيهِ وَأُمِّهِ وَأَبِيهِ وَصَاحِبَتِهِ وَبَنِيهِ. On that day, that the person would run away from his own brother, from his blood brother. I don't know him. He would disown him from his parents, from his wife, from his spouse, from his son and daughter. Everyone will be concerned about yourself. Poor. You will have no support. This person, maybe he was oppressed for a few years or was oppressed until he died. But you're going to spend the rest of your life in hell. You have to answer these questions before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the sacred hadith, Ya ibadi, inni harramtu dhulma ala nafsi, وَجَعَلْتُهُ بَيْنَكُمْ مُحَرَّمًا فَلَا تَظَالَمُ. He began by himself. He says, my servants, I have forbidden oppression for myself. I shall not oppress anyone. Then I made it prohibited for you. You should not oppress one another. You should not wrong one another. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, أَظُلْمُ ظُلُمَاتٌ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. This oppression in this life will be darkness on the day of judgment. And he says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if anyone have wronged his brother, an aunt, let him ask him for a relief. Beg him for forgiveness. Before a day will come, there will not be a dirham nor a dinar. I heard of somebody who used to play this dirty game and spy against Muslims and report them falsely. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tested him with cancer, which ruined his entire body, bone marrow and everything. So when he realized that it's too late and no one could help him by any means, his party, those who are paying him, would not benefit him by any means. He's just a rotten dog. So he went door to door to people whom he was the main cause for destroying their families, destroying their lives, knocking on their door and said, I'm at guilt. It was me who destroyed your life. Would you forgive me? And no one would forgive him. فَلْيَتَحَلَّلْهُ مِنْهُ مِنْ قَبْلِ أَنْ يَكُونَ يَوْمٌ لَا دِرْهَمٌ فِيهِ وَلَا دِنَارٌ. As far as the answer for this question, for your Christian sister, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give you an immediate relief. This is what I can say.
Ameen.
But the legal point, yes, if your husband is away for a while, he is known as al-ghaib in fiqh, he's absent, and his absence is not known for how long would it last. There is no financial support, no mutual support. We don't have an infinite period. So accordingly, you can ask for a separation. And may Allah, if there is a harm that is encountering you, but if you don't endure this, his absence patiently, may Allah reward you for that. But you have all the right to ask the court for a separation. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us our sins and give you an immediate relief and to your husband as well.
Ameen. Jazakallah khair, Sheikh, for all the answers today. Okay, with that, we come to the end of this episode of Ask Huda. If you want to send us any of your questions, please do by email at ask@huda.tv. Well, until next time, we both leave you with Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
If my love is attached to thee, then from sins I will be free. Each time my heart will beat, your name will resound with heat. Allah is my heart's speech, your mercy is what I beseech. Keep in my heart your remembrance, and in your deen allow me to advance. Help me in my quest, permit me to pass the ultimate test. Help me in my quest, permit me to pass the ultimate test. Help me in my quest, permit me to pass the ultimate test. Help me in my quest, permit me to pass the ultimate test.